What's the best computer for music production? What should you look for and why? Should you go for Intel or AMD? In this video, we'll explain all of this, and we're going to build a real beefy music production computer from scratch, showing you all the various components needed for such a build. Are you on a tight budget? Don't worry, we'll also be showing you some budget options. So, I'll refer to the expert.
If you're looking to buy a new computer, ideally suited for music production, then you have to carefully choose all the right components. Today, we're going to build a brand new computer from scratch, and I'll take you through the process and show you what parts I ended up going for and why. But before we start the actual build, you first need to understand what you should look for when buying a new computer for music production, whether it being a stationary computer or a laptop. Because there are many pitfalls to avoid, and you can easily end up wasting your hard-earned money if you're not aware of these things. Audio processing is one of the most CPU-intensive tasks people do on computers today, because it relies on real-time processing. Applications such as video editing rely heavily on parallel processing, which basically means that the work can be spread over the various cores in your CPU. Video editing and games also get a lot of help from your video card. Music production, on the other hand, relies solely on the CPU, and unlike many other applications, it doesn't utilize parallel processing very well. Instead, it relies heavily on serial processing instead. In a DAW, there's a long list of tasks that must be processed in sequence. For example, plugins must wait for instructions from the piano roll and arranger before they make a sound. Effects must wait for the audio upstream instruments and effects before they can process it. It's not possible to parallel process instruments and effects that are on the same mixer channel at the same time. The effects processing has an order from top to bottom in the mixer, and they all have to be processed one after the other. Modern processors tend to favor more cores over single core performance, and there's a good reason for this. Having more cores is like having several processors in one chip. This means that it can do more work at the same time, and most applications are written specifically to take advantage of this capability. Overall, it's better to have more cores since more work can be done at the same time in parallel. However, when it comes to music production, single-core performance now suddenly becomes much more important because you can't always process in parallel. Sure, you'll still benefit from having more cores, of course, but only to an extent. This has to do with the way all DAWs process information. Here's a very simplified example I've set up to illustrate. Try to imagine that these cups are CPU cores, and that the water is the audio workload. Let's drill a small hole at the bottom and pretend that this is the rate at which the core can process information. It works fine as long as the workload isn't too great. But as soon as one of the cores reaches 100%, it will spill over, and now there will be crackling and glitches in my audio playback. Now I could keep adding more cores, but as you can see, that won't really address the main problem, since much of what happens with audio processing can't be processed in parallel. Simply put, there's a lot of waiting going on.
It's kind of like making a pizza. You can't make the dough and cook the pizza at the very same time. It all needs to happen in the correct sequence. Try to imagine that the CPU cores are chefs. Adding more chefs in this case won't help at all.
This logic applies to all DAWs. Don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that a DAW can't utilize parallel processing, because it can. I'm just saying that it's not as efficient as in many other applications.
When choosing a computer for music production, the first thing you should look at is single core performance. You typically want to get the CPU with the best single core performance you can get within your budget, but you still want a reasonable number of cores. For example, it's better to have a 6-core CPU with fast single-core performance than having an 8-core CPU with slow single-core performance. So now that you know a little bit about what to look for in a CPU, let's look at laptops versus stationary computers. There's pros and cons to both. If you're constantly on the move, then a laptop is the obvious choice. Well, the cons with a laptop, though, is that they typically offer far less performance for the price versus a stationary computer. They also tend to heat up easily due to insufficient cooling, and you'll end up with a lot of fan noise. A stationary computer is typically much faster, cheaper, and quieter. Well, the downside, of course, is that it's stationary. It's not very mobile. When it comes to operating systems, it doesn't really matter if you use Windows or Mac. Use whatever you like and whatever's supported by your DAW of choice. That said, I should point out that you will usually get more performance for your money if you go the PC option. You typically want to go for no less than 8 GB of RAM. I recommend 16 GB to be on the safe side. Again, go for the CPU with the fastest single-core performance, and use an SSD if you have huge libraries like Nexus, Omnisphere, and so on, since SSDs are much faster than traditional spinning disk drives. A DAW can't utilize the GPU for audio processing, so you don't need an expensive graphics card. Many plugins still rely on GPU-accelerated graphics, though, but most low- and mid-range graphics cards will be good enough for that. I'd go for one with multi-monitor support, though. Using two or more monitors can really speed up your workflow. Last but not least, go for a quiet PC. There's nothing more annoying than fan noise when you're trying to produce. Fan noise can also be a huge annoyance when recording. Let's move to the actual build. I'm going to put some links to the parts I'm using in the description below so that you can build the same computer yourself. I'll also add links for some pre-built computers as well, just in case you're not comfortable building your own computer. Here's the foundation of my new rig. I went for this clean and stylish-looking case from Fractal Design, the Define R6. The main reason I chose this case? Because it's very quiet. It has sound isolation material covering all the surfaces on the inside, making it extremely quiet, and as a music producer, this is very important. The Fractal Design R6 comes with two fans in the front and one at the rear. Installing hard drives is extremely easy. They can be mounted on these vibration-insulated plates. The most important thing for a music production computer is the CPU. So, should you go for AMD or Intel? In 2019, AMD didn't really have anything that could compete in the high-end CPU segment. But that has changed. AMD is back with a vengeance, and not long ago, they crushed Intel in terms of raw performance in their new Ryzen CPUs. I had originally decided to go for the AMD 5950X this time around. But then Intel came out with their Alder Lake architecture, featuring a brand new design with performance and efficiency cores. This CPU is quite interesting from a music production standpoint, because it addresses some of the core issues that have been problematic in the past when it comes to single-core intensive tasks. The efficiency cores will handle background tasks, while the performance cores are then free to deal with high-intensive tasks. This prevents constant cycling between background tasks and the audio processing, which could be hugely beneficial for music production. Intel has lowered their prices significantly lately, and right now, the i9-12900K is actually cheaper than the Ryzen 9-5950X, which I was originally going to buy. According to benchmarks, the 12900K is also faster overall, even though the 5950X has more threads, which is quite impressive. The 12900K also has slightly faster single-core performance overall, which is hugely important. Another bonus is that the 12900K also supports the new DDR5 memory. Unless AMD lowers their prices significantly, I can't really recommend the 5950X over the 12900K right now. I therefore decided to go for an Intel i9-12900K. Note that you'll need Windows 11 in order to get the most out of this CPU because Windows 10 doesn't currently have the upgraded scheduler. Here's the components I chose for this build. As you can see, the motherboard I went for is the ASUS ROG Strix Z690F Gaming Wi-Fi. If you don't need Bluetooth and Wi-Fi and extra features like that, then you can go for a cheaper model. Here's an alternative budget option.
Again, I'll put all the Amazon links to these parts in the description and a pinned comment below so that you can build the same computer yourself. If you're not comfortable building your own computer, I'll also add links to some pre-built computers as well. I'll keep these links updated, by the way, so that they'll stay relevant. Now, let's move to the actual build. The first thing you want to do is to install the power supply. Next, put the CPU into the socket on the motherboard and install the RAM and any M.2 drives. It's easier to do this first before you fasten the motherboard to the case. Just follow the instruction manuals. Then you install the cooler and the hard drives, video card, etc. It's really not that hard to do, and there are many detailed YouTube videos showing how to do this step by step. I installed 32 gigabytes of RAM. For most people, though, 16 will be more than enough. Another important thing to consider is cooling. Besides performance, you also want the computer to be quiet. Noise is key here, or rather the lack of it. You could either go for air or water cooling, and there are pros and cons for both. Let's look at water cooling first. I started out with an ML240L from Cooler Master. This worked fine, but became too noisy under moderate loads, so I decided to go all in instead. This is the Cooler Master PL360 Flux. It comes with three ultra-quiet 120mm flux fans and a much bigger radiator. During normal operation, the fans can actually stop completely, so the solution ensures quiet operation. You also get a cleaner-looking case with more space and unrestricted airflow. You can adjust the RGB colors with the included software. The PL360 Flux provides excellent cooling and, at idle, the temperature stayed around 30 degrees Celsius. During a lengthy stress test, the maximum temperature never exceeded 79 degrees Celsius. Next, let's look at air cooling. In order to keep the CPU at acceptable temperatures, you'll need a beefy cooling solution. This is the Noctua NH-D15S Chroma Black. This is the king of air coolers, and I've been using this for years. I'm glad to see that they've been able to upgrade the finish compared to the old ones. This one looks much better. The NH-D15S is extremely large and will take up a lot of space in your cabinet. Because of its size, it will have to be rotated 180 degrees to clear the VRM heatsink on this particular motherboard. At idle, the temperatures were sitting around 30 degrees, same as the water cooler. During the same stress test, the maximum temperature reached 86 degrees Celsius, which is only 7 degrees more than the more expensive water cooler. If you'd like even better cooling, you can easily attach a second fan. I used an NH-D15 in my previous build as well, because these are extremely quiet. In fact, it's just as quiet as the water cooler, so there's no notable difference there. During normal use, you can't really hear either one of these coolers. During the stress test with the fans at maximum, the water cooler turned out to be slightly noisier, but it also provided better cooling. So, as you can see, both coolers provided really good cooling, and the difference wasn't really that great. You'll have to decide for yourself what works best for you. The PL360 Flux is aesthetically more pleasing. It takes up less space and provides slightly better cooling. That said, the Noctua NH-D15S isn't far behind, and it's also half the price. A cooler like this will basically last forever, and you don't run the risk of catastrophic failure. That said, a failure is extremely rare, but still, it's something to keep in mind. The PL360 Flux comes with a 5-year warranty, and I'm confident it will outlast your rig. They're both really good coolers, and you have to decide for yourself what's most important to you. Now, let's look at how this computer performs compared to my old i9-9900K based system. Here's the benchmark comparison. The 9900K is still a very capable CPU, but as you can see, the 12900K is significantly faster. Here's how it performed in Windows 10. And here's how it performed in Windows 11. There's a slight improvement in Windows 11.
Windows 11 has an improved scheduler optimized for Alder Lake CPUs, so I recommend that you run Windows 11 with this CPU. Benchmark tests can only tell you so much, though, so let's see how they compare in a real-life scenario. I suspect the faster DDR5 memory might also play a role here. I've experimented with dual and quad-channel memory before, and I saw a significant performance drop when going from quad to dual-channel memory. Now, this doesn't tell the whole story. All these tests were run with the audio buffer at 1024 samples. The 5820K couldn't handle anything below that. The 9900K could run it at 768, but just barely. The problem is, you can't really record anything with the buffer that high due to latency. Now, behold the 12900K. Let's go lower. No problem. Let's go even lower. 48 samples. That's just insane. Keep in mind that the overclocked 9900K was barely able to run this at 768 samples. To sum it up, if you're looking for a new computer which is going to be dedicated to music production, go for a CPU with the fastest single-core performance you can afford. If you're looking for the best computer for music production today, the i9-12900K and the Ryzen 9 5950X will both provide more than enough performance for most people. Many of you won't need that kind of computing power. Some of the older i7 CPUs might be more than enough, and even the i5, depending on what kind of music you make and how large your projects are. The mid-range Ryzen CPUs are great and provide plenty of performance at an affordable price. Get at least 16GB of RAM and preferably an SSD to minimize lag when loading libraries and such. The same rule applies if you prefer a laptop. If you're going for a laptop, I recommend getting one that's a bit faster than what you actually need to make sure you don't max it out, which will cause excessive heat and noise. I landed on Intel this time because it has slightly better single-core performance and DDR5 memory. It's also cheaper right now. You only really need this if you make huge projects and you need the very best of the best. If you're willing to wait, then AMD will come out with a new platform which will also support DDR5 memory later this year. There's always something better around the corner.
And remember, you'll find links to all these components and pre-built computers in the description below.
Hit that like button if you enjoyed this video, and don't forget to subscribe and click the bell if you want to see more videos like this. Thanks for watching.